because I've got to speak here on Saturday week. My daughter's getting married, but that day we're having a reception in this room. So the chance to be able to just check the mic out. It's obviously unrivaled. But my job here as the host of the Cavalry Club is really to introduce you to Nick Dyer. Nick Dyer, an award-winning wildlife photographer, and he did the thing that a lot of us probably wished we had done but didn't have the guts to do it, which was actually give up our nice cosy job in London and go off into the bush and follow our passion. And that is exactly what he's done, and he has done, I think, an incredible job. He spent 6 years living with these dogs in Manapur, so you'll see some of his work very, very shortly. But this evening wouldn't be possible without just mentioning some thanks to one or two people, in particular to David Cowdery and Alex Farmer of the Cavalry Guards Club here, who have given this complete venue for charity on behalf of the Painted Wolf Foundation. The drinks that we've been drinking courtesy of somebody called Jeremy Borg, who is runs a South African wine company called Painted Wolves, for Lena. And then also, I think it's definitely a thanks is due to Andrew and Julia Mama, who are great friends of ours who live in Zimbabwe. And they introduced myself and Ali, my wife, in 2013 to Marlon Pools. We fell in love with it. And she was also responsible for introducing Nick and I. So I'm thrilled that this has all come full circle and we can get involved in this. And also particularly thanks to you all for coming tonight, because the mere fact that you've come means that you care about Painted Wolves, the African Wild Dog, and I hope that by doing what we're doing, it's one of the first events that we've had like this, that we can raise one awareness and two finance to assist the lives of these iconic beasts in Africa. And I'm sure that at the end of 40 odd minutes, which is what Nick is going to talk for, your knowledge and love of these beasts will be a lot greater than it probably is right now. Even though I know a lot of you have been in Africa, you've seen these wild dogs, and if you haven't done that, you've probably seen David Attenborough's piece on dynasties, which he did pre-Christmas. But anything that I can do and the rest of us can do to improve the lot of these iconic beasts would be much appreciated. And we're going to have a book signing, and there are some pledge forms which we can to post the talk after we've had some more drinks. So welcome, and let me hand over to you.
Thanks, Mark.
Can I start by saying a pronounced word? Can I also just start by saying thank you very much to the club? I mean, this is an incredible venue, and it's a real privilege to be here. And also thanks very much, Mike, for arranging this all. I mean, this is a fantastic experience for me. And I'd also the wine you're drinking is Painted Wolf wine, run by my very good friend and huge Painted Wolf supporter, Jeremy Borg. So welcome everybody, and it's a absolute delight to see so many old friends, family, old colleagues, and people I've never met before. But it's I hope that we will all share something at the end of this talk, which will be an understanding of the Painted Wolf and basically what it is that makes it so fascinating to me. So I better start by saying a little bit about myself. Just for people who don't know me, or those who are slowly losing their memory and can't remember what I was like. Very few people, or many people, remember me in a suit, and other people don't recognize me at all, because that's not normally what I do. because that is not, that's my life now, but it's not what it was. So I was raised in Kenya for most of my childhood, and then came to start working in the city in the early 1980s, and spent 10, 15 years as a fund manager running US equities. And then after that, I did take a sabbatical and escape to Australia for a year to cross every desert there with my then ex-wife. My then wife. And then I came back and I started a marketing company again based in the city, which was very successful for about another 12 years, until about 2012, when I had really had enough. I think in all that time, my careers in the city, there was something inside me that was missing, and that I felt there was an emptiness, that I wasn't really being fully fulfilled. As much as I was enjoying working there, working with many of you who are here tonight. So again, I did get one escape for a year and a half when I gave up on managing, crossing the deserts, but then I came back. And it wasn't until 2012 when I decided enough's enough and I left. And that's where the ex-wife came in. I returned to Africa, to Kenya, where I grew up. And I was met with a very, very different Africa to the one I left. It was a vibrant place. It was really a place that was changing. And I made up my mind that I was not going to look at Africa through the childhood nostalgic eyes that I, you know, that was a good temptation, but to really look at it the way it is. I bought a Land Cruiser and I set off on my travels to explore Eastern Africa and most of Southern Africa. And I did it all by myself. Effectively, I'd had a tent, I had two chairs, a table, a hammock, and that's my car, and a box of matches. The idea was to explore. So I had lots of adventures in terms of seeing places. This was taken in the Kalahari, which I crossed by myself, which took 10 days. And then this is just a few examples of the things that I got to see. I followed the Zambezi up towards its source, through Zambia, and these are the Ingonia Falls. It was just an absolutely incredible, beautiful experience. I also visited, in every country I went to, at least two of the main national parks, so I could actually see the differences. I spoke to conservationists, people in the tourism industry, really trying to understand about the challenges and the issues. But above all, what I did was I would actually turn up and spend time with different people, different communities that lived alongside wildlife. So, these are two great, very good friends of mine, Pelo and Daniel, who are Maasai. I also turned up in Namibia, Bushman land, and spent some time with the San Bushmen. And again, in Namibia also, for instance, with the Himba tribes in northwest Namibia. The interesting thing I did, my trick was, is I used to have a little Canon printer called a selfie. And generally, I was probably not always welcomed. But I would take a few pictures, and they would sort of like, no, not another tourist, and then print off a picture of them. And that sort of like kind of ingratiated me. Mm-hmm. And then I could actually chat with them about how they really were, what they really felt, and what was going on in their lives. And one of the things that became very clear was just how bad and how big the human-wildlife conflict is. These were people living in remote areas, but then when you actually got down near the cities, near the towns, human expansion is pushing up against the last remaining wildernesses of Africa. But more of that later, because in 2013 I discovered what to me was a paradise, and that is Manipools in northern Zimbabwe, which is a little Garden of Eden that sits below on the south banks of the Zambezi River, and where you're able as a person to spend time with the animals almost as it was in the time of Eden. And that's the only way I can describe it, because literally you've pitched your tent and you will get these most incredibly lovely visitors. It is the only park in Africa that allows you to walk by yourself on foot, albeit at your own risk. Because while you're there, there are these elephants. That's the hammock I mentioned. And literally, I would, every afternoon, I'd have a snooze in the heat of the day. It gets up to about 50 degrees centigrade. And I would have him, and I would wake up, and he would be above me, saying, I want to go for a drink down in the river, which is just on the other side of that termite mound. But he wouldn't, you know, and I would fall out in utter panic. But he would be there, and other elephants. Lions would walk through. You really were with the wildlife. And because it's a walking park, they're kind of a little bit more forgiving than in other areas of Africa. And so that started my, this to me was a paradise for photography, because what it enabled me to, A, get low down shots and, you know, get great angles with the animals, get up close with the animals, but also, that's me taking some pictures of some lions while they're eating an eland. But it, what was so impressive about it was that you actually got to interact with them. When you're in a game viewer, all they see is the game viewer. They don't see you. But if you're on foot, they know you're there. Therefore, there's something tremendously personal when you're actually with that animal, and they have accepted you. You treat them with the most utmost respect. You know, and you don't get in their way, and they're very tolerant. But from that, to be able to get pictures where they're looking at you, where they're connecting with you, where they are, you know, that there is a connection, and that is, yeah, that is what I love, and that's what drives the passion. And so this became an absolute paradise for me. It wasn't always so easy. Sometimes you got it wrong. One thing I learned about walking with animals was I had some amazing guides like John Stevens, who really taught me so much about how to stay alive, which so far has worked. Although that's not to say, what I learned was that there are three C's, or there are five C's to walking with wildlife. At first you start, you're very careful, and then you become confident. And then after that, you become a little complacent, and then you become careless, and then you're culled. So, and I've had a few close shaves, not with here, but there's me, which instead of someone coming to help me, was just busy clicking away as I was charged by a young bull elephant, which was actually quite an experience. I was about charged four times. But I never let go of my camera. So that became an absolute paradise for me. And then I met these guys. And I remember the very first time I saw the dogs of Manipools. This is part of Tate's pack, who was in the Dynasties film. And I was driving in my car at that stage in 2013, very nervous to get out of it. And a guide said, come with me, come with my guests, and just walk with them. And we walked with them when they set off hunting. And it was the most exciting experience. We just carried on walking, 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 and suddenly they broke. Pandemonium erupted, and impala and dogs were everywhere. And I'm just throwing my camera around, trying to get something or the other. You know, trying to, I mean, it was just the most beautiful experience. You were in a wild dog hunt, which was incredible. So that started my love for them. And I suppose this is a good time to start telling you a little bit about them as to why they have become such a passion. So this is a female wild dog, or painted dog, or painted wolf, or cape hunting dog. Regardless, its Latin or scientific name is Lycaon pictus, which actually means painted wolf. But to me, she's Triss of the Nyakasanga pack. I did get to know them all individually. And the thing about, everyone argues about the names, but it's really not that important. In fact, it's quite ironic that this little animal has so many names and there's so few of them. But to me, beyond what you know, what we call them, is getting to understand them. So physically, we can see that they have two huge ears. They're not dogs and they're not wolves, and that's the first thing to know. You've got Canidae, which is the canids, and in there there's two families. One is Canis, which has the coyotes. The wolves are domestic dogs, which are all descendants from the European wolf. You've got jackals, you've got dholes, you've got dingoes, all those guys. And then you've got Lycaon, and this is the only member, Lycaon pictus, of that family. There are about as close to each other to a domestic dog or a wolf as we are to baboons. Now, I know some of you know people who you think, but trust me, they are not related at all. They do not have a dew claw on their front legs. And also they don't have their dentures or dentition or whatever it is are all very, very different. They live in packs. So the packs may be from maybe a pack could just be an alpha female and an alpha male, right up to 40 or 50 dogs. They also bond. I mean, they're very closely bonded together, and they care for each other. They're like musketeers, all for one and one for all. And one of the most joyous things is they hunt in the morning and the evening, and then they sleep all day. And at about 5:15, they will suddenly all leap up, and they have what's called a greeting ceremony. It's as if they have not seen each other for months. They're like long-lost lovers at an airport. And they're there, they dance, they chase, and as if it's just an absolute joy just to be alive and be together again. They are also Africa's most efficient predator. They can reach on their hunts speeds of up to 60 kilometers an hour. Some say, I think it's a bit of an exaggeration, but some say 80% of their hunts result in a kill, which when they hunt twice a day, I mean, that's lions, you know, are probably 20-30%, so much less. But they're not wanton killers. When they're nomadic, that's when they're not denning, they move around in huge, long areas that can be anything from, you know, 300-400 square kilometers right up to several thousand square kilometers, taking small picks from the herds, but not actually trying to wipe them out, which I think is quite environmentally friendly. But to see the hunt, and I explained, I know I said that, I mean, this is Black Tips pack, in fact, Black Tips there, and that's just the launch of the attack. And to me, it's very much like that quote in Julius Caesar, cry havoc, let slip the dogs of war. And that is what it's actually like. It's absolutely fantastic. But the kills are very quick. You know, the pack suddenly descends on them, their prey is ripped apart very, very quickly. Death comes within seconds. Unlike lions, who can spend 3 hours, or I've seen 45 minutes, lions decide to try and kill a buffalo. This is actually quite humane by comparison, but very, very efficient. They're not always successful in terms of the chases. This poor impala thought it would be better to dive into the Chizasiku pool, and then the crocodiles decided the fate, and the poor little dog was on the shore, like, weeping for his lost supper. The other thing amazing about them is that they don't compete with aggression. Lions compete very aggressively. A male lion will eat first, then the lioness, and then the cubs get the scraps. It's totally reverse with the dogs. So first the pups will have their fill, then any injured dog, and this is Amos, and that is Hornet, and Amos is giving his brother, making sure that he's actually fed. And then often it's the alpha female who actually eats last. So one of the most amazing things that, you know, lots of people have huge amounts of theories and think they know the wild dogs, and Peter Blinston, who I wrote a book with, said to me the best thing when someone says, but dogs do this, don't they, is to say maybe. So they never eat baboons. But in Manipal's, while I was there, starting in 2014, they started to predate on baboons. And this was quite incredible because the baboon population was exploding, which is causing all sorts of damage because they were raiding guinea fowl nests. And so therefore, guinea fowls try and keep, eat the seeds and keep insects down, which actually allows the grass to grow. And the dogs decided to do something about it, to restore a balance to the ecosystem. And that's I don't want to get more gruesome than that, but that was like quite an incredible day when I actually caught, the BBC missed it, but which is delightful. I was lucky enough to see this incredible kill of a baboon. Very, very quick. I looked at my camera at my film afterwards, and it literally, the whole thing just took about 5 seconds, and that was it. But then they all ate, the pups ate, and what was, I don't know if any of you have seen that photograph. That was an aftermath of a baboon hunt. And it's with Black Tit's pack, the Nyakasanga. And I was so lucky that this actually, you know, gave me a place in the Wildlife Photography of the Year competition run by the Natural History Museum. But I mean, it is extraordinary behavior, but it looks a bit gruesome. But having said that, the dogs the little puppies are having so much fun. And I love the fact that the baboon's got a look on its face saying, well, when you finish, will you just put me down? Which is a similar one a few weeks later, which I call, whatever happens, keep smiling. So, again, grim, I mean, the poor baboon was actually well gone. But what was quite funny, I was lying flat on my stomach by myself, the adults were like, just carry on playing to the pups. And this particular pup kept on coming up to me with a baboon's head in its mouth, like, do you want to join in too? It's really good fun. But they are endearing. But where they get incredibly endearing is when you see them at the den. And they are the most cute, gorgeous creatures. But in addition, is just to see how the pack looks after the young. And it is not just one dog, just the mother. It's only the alpha female that breeds with one alpha male. And the rest of the pack spends its time looking after the little pups. And you first see them come out of the hole, and then gradually over the next 3 months when they're in the den, you see all the adults playing a role in teaching them how to survive when they have to go nomadic, gradually giving them confidence, gradually extending their boundaries. This is Patrick, who's one of Tammy's males and a daughter of Black Tip. But I love this because he's talking to the little pups. And I don't know if you remember that Rudyard Kipling poem, This is the Law of the Jungle. And it's almost as if he's sort of like giving them their first lecture on how to behave. And I think the actual last line of that poem is never kill for the sake of killing, and seven times never kill man. And never when I've been with these animals have I ever felt under threat. Hmm. So, yeah, sorry, that's just make you go, ah. And then after 3 months at Oden, the little pups head out onto the floodplain, and they've suddenly got this huge expanse of land where they've been confined to the den, and it is fun in the open areas, and they just sort of like just run around charging, attacking each other, biting each other, nibbling each other, and this one is just like looking down that one's throat as it grows up saying, my, what big teeth you've got. But it is, and then as the pups play, and again after the greeting ceremony, the adults get bored and they sit down for a bit, and then the pups continue to play and play and play, and then the adults say, this is too much fun to miss out, and immediately they start playing and everyone joins in. But this is also one of Black Tip's daughters, which her name is Taku. She's now an alpha female of her own pack. But the BBC called her Pip because she has the collar on. So with the tracking gear, it always goes Pip, Pip. So this was either Pip or Taku. So they've all got names and they're all incredible individuals. Tris, who I showed you a picture of the very first slide, we nicknamed her Doc. Any time that an adult got, or a pup got wounded, she would come along and start licking it. And so she was like the pack's medic. But as I say, fun, you know, I can, as a photographer, spend hours and hours and hours in front of sleeping lions and sleeping leopards. But these guys are extremely exciting to actually be near, to witness, and to photograph. So, natural enemies in the wild, they've got two. One is the hyena, and it's incredible how many people actually think they are the same. Well, they're kind of not. A hyena is twice the size of a wild dog, and a hyena is more related to a bear, even a cat, than it is to a canid. So, yeah, they're nothing to do with the same. But they do fight like cats and dogs. And one of the main causes of death is hyena attacks, where the hyenas come in and will, in an attempt to steal food, start killing the pups. And it's quite horrible to see. Of a litter of 10, you can perhaps expect only 5 to survive, and often it's either hyena attacks or lions as well. A little story about that picture was I was very happily following the dogs on a hunt, and they made a kill. They brought the pups for the first time to the actual kill, as opposed to taking the food to the things, and 3 bloody lions leapt out on them. And I was just sitting there under a tree, and that is one of 3 lions that I knew, and they were, in fact, the pride's called the Spice Girls, because there's 5 girls in that pride, and 2 sub-adult males, but this was just 3 of them. And the dogs just, I shouted, because I thought, gosh, they're going to get the pups. And then the dog said, bye. And I was just left there with 3 lions, which was not the most it was incredibly worrying. She started coming towards me, and in fact I was with a girl called Farai who did those amazing illustrations in the book, and she had been telling me all week how unscared of lions she was. She had brown eyes and they were that big when she saw the lion. And Anyhow, so I shouted, and then it stopped, but it was just running in front of me with its tail swishing and its spitting and growling. And then I just started talking to it. I was here first, absolutely fine, just trying to calm it down because it was as scared as I was. And then I could see Farai. Her eyes were that big, as well, you know, just terrified. And I said, Farai, just talk to them. She can smell your fear. So she says, it's okay, we're not food. And in those moments of sheer panic, you have some clarity of either total fear of what am I going to do there. I have my bear banger, which is this flare that we should fire at them and explode and chase them away, but that doesn't always work. And then utter hysterics at what Farai just said. But anyway, so then the girl who wasn't scared of lions, we walked back after about 8 minutes, and then this lion walked into the most perfect light. So I sat down, opened up my tripod 50 meters away, and started photographing. She's like, what the hell do you think you're doing? So we had to go back to my car, which was a couple of kilometers away. So, but at least I got one shot. So the other, you know, the thing to say is that what makes these dogs so, or wolves, or whatever you like to call them, so important. And I've always thought that what it is that they are run by the alpha female. They care for each other. She's the general. She leads the hunts. She decides on absolutely everything. And she's also a caring mother. And I think, unlike lions, which is very male-dominated, this female leadership is what makes them so wonderful. But I didn't think that until I was watching Brexit. But I think it certainly works for the dogs, even if it isn't with us humans. I started doing this in 2013. In 2015, the BBC came in. They spent 2 years filming Dynasties. We were often side by side together. That's Nick Dyer, who's the producer, Warwick Sloss. I mean, all incredibly talented people. I don't know who's seen that film. The camera work is just really unbelievable. We spent two years together learning each other, discussing their behavior, really trying to understand more and more and more about, you know, what's making these guys tick. So when I started doing this photography, it was all about me. It was all about wanting an award, wanting to be recognized, wanting to be able to stand up here and have people listen to me about me. It was a very ego thing. And then one day, I was walking back. I'd spent about 4 hours following the dogs on an amazing hunt. And I was walking back, and I suddenly thought, what I've just seen, no one sees. This is just incredible. And I just felt, I've sort of like had to show promising signs of being a photographer. So I thought, I have a duty to share this privilege that I've been given. And it almost was like some Damascene moment that was just, this is what I have to do now. And then I came round, this is by a place called BBC, for those who know Manipur, came round the corner of a bush, and there was this buffalo, almost, you know, from me to that door over there, looking at me. And buffaloes are the most dangerous, you know, these dagger boys, we call them, male buffaloes, the most dangerous things in the bush. And I'm standing face to face. And so from that Damascene moment, I suddenly thought, I wish I'd never seen a bloody camera. And certainly never heard of Manipul's. Very fortunately, it ran round the tree. And this always reminds me of my headspace there. This tree, and then stood above me, probably where that pillar is, just looking at me, and I thought, I'm dead. But then very fortunately, it ran off into the bush the other way. I was very lucky. But it is a marker. And what I did notice is that he was as scared as I was, because he's actually weeing himself. but it was that point that I suddenly thought, and I think maybe because I had started to do the research for the book, that I was beginning not only to understand more about how these animals lived in the wild, when they're far away from the ravages of human beings, which is minor pools. But I was learning more about their history and the challenges they face today. So let's talk a bit about those, because this is a map of Africa and shows the dogs and their diversity in probably 1910. And then if we just move on, that the estimated population was 500,000. Today, this is where you might find dogs, but their numbers have dropped from 500,000 to 6,500, and that's been left, and that's all that are left across the whole of Africa in the wild. But what caused that? Well, the number of things, but the first thing is obviously, like lions, elephants, giraffes, everything, there is a loss of habitat as human populations have increased. But something worse happened to these animals. In 1916, when Europeans, farmers, started bringing their farming techniques to this, to Africa, the hate for the dogs grew and grew and grew. And in 1916, this is from southern, this is copied all over Africa, but this is southern Rhodesia. There was a reward. If you brought in a tail, you were given, I think it's 5 shillings for every tail. They were treated as vermin, and the aim was to completely exterminate them. That ruling only stopped in 1978. Today they are a protected species, but that doesn't mean that their challenges are no longer there. Snaring is one of the most incredible killers of the dogs. Effectively what happens is local communities are poor, are hungry, want to catch an impala, some bushmeat. They put snares in animal tracks, and the dogs walk through them and are regularly found snared and killed around that area. In addition to that, there are road kills, killing an enormous number of dogs, and disease. Rabies and distemper spread from domestic dogs and wipe out packs and even in entire populations in a single area. Fortunately, there are a number of heroes across the whole of Africa who are trying desperately to keep these animals alive and to try and grow the packs. This is Peter Blinston of Painted Dog Conservation, who I actually worked with. There he's putting on collars, tracking them. There's a number of things that can be done. Research, following the packs, warning communities when the actual animals are coming into their vicinity of their livestock. Anti-poaching patrols to actually pick up snares and try and catch people laying them. But probably the biggest battle and the biggest area where real changes can be made is working with the community. And Peter that's the chief. And he is a trustee of the Painted Wolf Foundation. And he's brought into the whole program. And the organization, which raises money worldwide, builds boreholes for his community, gardens for growing vegetables and so on and so forth, has AIDS clinics and maternity clinics dotted around in the various villages around the community, has a bush camp which takes over 1,500 kids a year to come and spend a week in the bush camp, visit the Hwangi National Park, and generally for them it's like going to Disney World. They even take ex-poachers and prisoners who are in Wangi prison and get them to sing to the kids about let's not poach. So I mean there's phenomenal work being done by these guys. But the sad thing is that it's not fully working. There are gaps in this conservation. And one of the main things is that there's too many each of these organisations are just small little organisations looking after a very tiny area. And so what we're trying to do is to create an over arching organisation that is able to support them. So the first thing we're trying to do is awareness. Their biggest threat is that nobody knows who they are. So you know, most people, if you ask them, don't know what a painted wolf is, or a wild dog. And when I say I'm taking pictures of wild dogs, they think, so you run around the sort of like outskirts of Harare taking photographs of little mutts, and it's like, no. So, I mean, one of the things is, with that, without that awareness, there's also, they don't get the funds. So you've got the conservation top table, gorillas and tigers and lions and rhinos, chimps and elephants. They are taking all the conservation money because no one knows who these guys are. And why? Because, you know, you've got huge amounts of stories and, you know, it's in our, you know, in our, you know, Jungle Book or whatever it is, chimpanzees, lions, so forth. They're all in our culture. Wild dogs aren't. And so trying to get them back into the culture of getting people to understand them. You know, we produced the book. You know, the awards helped. Dynasties has been a huge help. And then, you know, we were very lucky. Richard Branson made a lot of noise about the work that we were doing, which is a, you know, a great help. The next thing is connection. All these organizations just work disparately around Africa. They don't connect, or not very well. So our idea is to try and bring all these guys together to discuss what the priorities are. And these are very clever scientists, very clever people. And we just want them to work together. And the other thing is that we need to then build an infrastructure, because all these guys go out, spend huge amounts of resources to try and get various funds. If this was in the business world, the right answer would be to take them over, rebrand them, create an infrastructure to be able to go for fundraising, have a good marketing department. But you can't have this just for all these little organizations. So consequently, the idea of the Painted Wolf Foundation is to be that, to be actually the marketing department, the fundraising department, the reporting department, and the awareness department. If we can do that, and we can build the infrastructure to do that, we can then get the big money that the elephants and the rhinos benefit from. UK aid, European Commission, you know, US aid, they spend hundreds of millions on conservation. And it would be lovely if the dogs could get some of that. So at the moment, we've got Peter Blinston, who's I mentioned, runs Painted Dog Conservation. Diane Skinner, who actually runs, has spent her life looking at charismatic species and fundraising for them, and myself, whatever I do. But we need other skill sets within our organisation. And I'm really delighted that Mike Cuthbert has actually agreed to become a trustee of the Painted Wolf Foundation. And I know his skills in the city are going to make a huge difference to what we actually do. So thank you, Mike, very much. So I think, you know, the question is that with the demands that there are, you know, for elephants and, you know, for all the other things that you might like in the wild, why do you really need to care about the dogs? Is it just because they're really cute? Or is it because we as humans have treated them that badly that we really want to, you know, do something better? I'm not sure, but there's another reason, which is actually why the dogs are really worth supporting. So that's why it was a free picture. So hopefully you can recognise those guys. I mean, the princes have done an absolutely phenomenal job in raising awareness of wildlife conservation. One of the things that they've done, though, is to focus on wildlife crime. And so consequently, all the money goes to to tackling wildlife crime. There's a bigger issue that I believe. There's the front line that is not being defended. And that is that between now and 2050, the African population is going to double. Okay, so the human wildlife conflict is going to explode. And it's fine, if you think about it, the GDP, the agriculture, share of GDP that agriculture has in the UK is 0.5%. In Africa, it's 20%. And yet we struggle to live alongside our badgers. And if you think about an African who has his crops trampled by an elephant, or his livestock taken by lion, and then, or even his child, the challenges are far greater than what we face over here. And yet we expect them to look after that their wildlife. And indeed, the attitude in conservation is to wag a finger at Africa and say, you should do better. And Africa's getting a little bit fed up with that. So the real answer is to work with communities. And the days, I mean, this was on a walk, I went hunting with Lassan, and we came across the bones of an elephant. And I was amazed to see the tusks actually lying there. And they said, oh, they've been there for months. I was like, but do you know what those are? I said, yeah, they're just another set of bones that come out of its mouth. They weren't really concerned that they were tusks. And I think the thing is, but now you've got the wildlife trade, where indigenous people live happily alongside wildlife is really coming to an end. And yet conservation can help. When I was in Wangi, there was reports of an attack of goats in a community. And so Jealous, who's the tracker, went off to the community to find out, because often it was made up. And they found all the dog tracks, and yes, the dog had killed a goat. So they went to the herdsman and said, I'm sorry, we're really sorry. I mean, what do you want in compensation? And they said, nothing. He said, you do so much for us. You've built us a borehole in the village. You've actually, my children go to the bush camp. You've done enough. What if I lose? I've got 8 goats and I've lost 1. It doesn't matter. And this is the message that Peter gets through all the time. Look what the dogs do for you. Without them, we'll lose it. There's Amy Dickman in Tanzania has another amazing program setting up camera traps. The villagers get points. If the cameras pick up a wild dog or a lion or whatever, and they get points. And points mean
prizes.
So there are really great programs going on that are involved with the community. And unless we actually focus our conservation efforts with the communities, then I really struggle with the doubling population to see how the wildlife has really a chance. And as far as Painted Dog Conservation or Painted Wolf Foundation is, we really want to focus on these efforts in the communities. So that's about all from me. My life has changed beyond means, and even when I gave up wanting an award, it's amazing I got one last year, so I was really pleased with that. But it seems that my life is no longer really mine. I seem to be doing all this for the dogs now, and I don't really seem to be in control of what the next step is. And I said to in a talk with a Zen Buddhist monk, and he said, you choose and then you are chosen. And it does feel like the dogs have taken control. My life has completely changed, but I'd just like to end by saying it's changed so much for the better. Thank you very much for listening. time to ask some questions. There is a mic here.
Thank you. I wanted to ask, when the wild dogs hunt, do they have a sort of individual role? Like often lions have a sort of purpose within the pride.
You will often see them heading off into the hunt, and there will be a leader. And there will some of the males are much better at hunting. Attenborough described something in the there was a series called The Hunt, which is talking about having telepathy. But as far as I can see, when they head off hunting, it's every dog for itself, and it's mayhem, it's chaos, it's lots of fun, and sometimes you get two on one. But they don't really have a role. It's just whatever they can get.
The alphas.
No, I know. I mean, I think the alpha decides where to hunt and when to hunt. I've seen some pretty rubbish dog hunts before they decided on the alpha. So she does play a very critical role. Yeah. Thank you.
Nick, you mentioned the clash with local populations. Where does tourism fit into your sort of structure? Is it a blessing or a curse?
That's very, very important. Tourism is really critical. Unless people come to see these guys, then they're not going to have a chance. Yeah. But it's also really important that if you're going on safari, that you're actually going to be contributing something to the communities that live there, that you're going to be contributing something to conservation. You know, I mean, I see too many times where people pay a $9,000 safari and it advertises, and $20 is being given to conservation. It's like, wow, you know, it's insulting. But there are organisations out there that actually take this very, very seriously. You know, from travel agents in this country to lodges out there where they have very active programs to actually support the wildlife. So I just recommend strongly that if you are going to go on holiday, on a safari, please really look into the conservation aspect of it. And increasingly what's going to need to happen is that the communities are going to have to own that asset and directly benefit from it, as opposed to large companies, if we want these animals to survive. Thank you.
Nick, that was absolutely outstanding. Thank you. Two very quick questions. I think I read 3 weeks ago that Blacktip was missing. Is that right? Or still the case? And secondly, how does an alpha female become an alpha female? Is it the same aggressiveness that you'd expect from the blacks?
Sure. So in terms of Blacktip, yeah, sadly, I don't think she made it. She was 10 years, she would have been 10 years old this year, which, like her mother Tate, that is an incredibly good, she died in her ninth year as well, so that's an incredibly good year age for a wild dog. And I kind of suspected that she wasn't going to be around this year, although it is like losing a member of, you know, a pet. So, and now they are trying to decide, you know, who the alpha female will be. Now there's three females left in the pack, but they're all kind of related. So it's really not too sure sort of how this is going to come out next. Henry Bandura, I don't know if you know, he was in the End of the Dynasties film talking about being able to smell one pack from another. He's a very good friend of mine. And he said that he had seen what you actually witness is a male and a female. Can I have the mic back? I think we've run it. Hello. I'm sorry. A male and a female. Will start urinating in the same area as each other, and then that's when you know that the new pair is actually bonding. Sometimes you will get males fighting. But once they've chosen the female, she stays there. You will often get a male on the top of this patch, but the female is the female. It's an interesting time to be in Mount Pools and see what's going on.
What sort of terrain are they effective in? Because Manipul is actually quite small, isn't it? And are they effective across various different types of terrain, or are they quite restricted?
The question is, are they? Where are they effective? In which areas? I mean, the incredible thing about the dogs is they've been seen at the coast, and they've been seen on the top of Mount Kilimanjaro by Bessinger. There's a big hole in the map when you look at that, and that's the Congo, which is just a huge rainforest, so they don't seem to be in there. But generally, they're very, very versatile into the terrains that they're actually in. Yes, please.
So you mentioned that engaging with the communities is a good way of raising awareness and concern. Is there an argument that we should globally revisit the idea of national parks and how we relate as humans relate to national parks? So almost a complete no-go area where no one goes and no one builds, and it's just nature.
I think so. Two things. I said to a very leading conservationist, having spent 6 months in Manipul, I said, if you could actually leave Manipul and know that every animal here would be fine just living out its daily life and no poachers will come in and everything like that, would you do it? He said no. Now, to me, without a doubt, I would just like to leave them alone. But the reality is if we leave, then there's going to be a huge, poachers will come in. The land has to be productive, because the real question that's facing these national parks is the opportunity cost. So you could take the Masai Mara, the Serengeti, and turn it into the most, it's grass, you could turn it into the most amazing wheat fields in Africa, feeding thousands of starving people. Yeah. Or you can keep it for a few meandering wildebeest. So unless you've got tourism in there, unless you've got it being producing something, then the wildlife really doesn't have a standard chance. And I'll make another point, because on hunting, so personally I would never, ever, ever want to hunt anything, but people do. And one of the crises that is being faced in Africa at the moment is because less and less people are hunting, the traditional hunting grounds are becoming unprofitable. So people are walking, so hunters are saying, no, we're giving up that area. So those areas, although few animals are being shot, were actually refuges for wildlife. And as they walk away, they turn into farms. They turn into, we'll log all the trees, we'll kill all the wildlife, the poachers move in. So there is a crisis in Africa, especially in Tanzania, where these hunting grounds are just suddenly no longer refuges for wildlife. So it's such a complicated area, but the big question is, how do you make it work for the people, for the country and the people who live around that wildlife? And unless we do, then I really don't see how we can actually hang on to these vast green spaces that don't exist on any other continent in the world.
Nick, thank you, this has been amazing. If we were going to see apart from Zimbabwe, where else? Zimbabwe, Zambia, Tanzania, I think you mentioned. That'd be question one. So where is it sort of working, really working? And second question, what's the relationship between this wild dog and the Indian wild dog?
The dole.
Answering the last one first.
A dole is a canid.
Yeah.
So related to the wolf, related to the coyote, etc., etc. And Lacayan Pictus is just out there on his own. But they all get called wild dogs. And one of the reasons we're calling them painted wolves is because the derogatory term, a dingo attacked a kid last week. And it said, child attacked by wild dogs. So that's why we prefer painted wolves. But in terms of your other question, where to see them, Botswana has the largest population, followed by Zimbabwe, Zambia. So I mean, they're good areas. Kenya had a fantastic population in Laikipia, but they got 300 dogs. From nothing, it went to 300 dogs in 12 years. And then they all got wiped out by distemper in 2017, bar about 10. So those countries, but I mean, but also if you do go, I would urge you, you know, work, you know, look for, there's a lot of struggling organizations there. And what we hope to do is, with the Painted Wolf Foundation, is to say, this is where you can go to see them, you know, where you're actually contributing to their conservation. What you actually get every so the pups are born, and then after about 2 years, the females go off in one direction of that litter, or most of them, and then the males go off, you know, after 2 years, and they go off to find other groups of wandering females and males, and in that respect, what they do is they keep the diversity of the gene pool. So this is what's really weird about this pack behind me, is that, you know, black tip's gone, but the three females that are left in the pack are all related to the current two alpha males. So I haven't had a chance in the last 2 days to look at Henry's pictures of these two dogs starting to mate and start to form a pair to know who she is. But it is Gianni, the old alpha male, that's doing it. Any other?
Good. You mentioned that the population of Africa is going to be doubling.
Yes.
In the rest of the world, the rest of the world has almost lost its wildlife, and the population of Africa has to grow. So how do you see the end for wildlife in Africa, and the fact that it's likely to become like the rest of the world?
Yeah, so absolutely. I mean, the headwinds against wildlife, I'm not standing here because I think I love the dogs and they're nice. The headwinds against wildlife are huge. I'm doing my best to see, from a non-conservation background, to think of other ways that we can actually raise money, raise support for an animal on the brink of extinction. And, you know, when you think of, you know, what I don't know is the work of the conservationist, yeah, reversing this awful decline that's gone on, is it just holding steady to a more enlightened age, or are we just slowing down an absolute decline? And there's no real answer to that. But if you follow what we've done here, what people in Europe done, America, Asia, they don't stand a chance. But I spoke to a load of Zimbabwean businessmen the other week at a dinner and said, it's in your hands. It's not just in the conservationists' hands, it's in Africa's hands. They don't have to keep these things alive. There's no reason why they have to, but there has to be incentive. They, as business leaders, us in our supporting roles, have to help them have to help them find the value that means that the Mara doesn't turn into a wheat field. And that is what we want to do with what we're doing, from small areas to more broader schemes, and that's why we need the funds. Mm. Chris?
Following on from that, Nick, I mean, with the crocodile now having kicked out Mugabe,
oh, right.
Is there a scene change or an improvement in conservation in Zimbabwe?
I'll say this about conservation in Zimbabwe. So if you look at Mozambique, Tanzania, so if you look at areas around Zambia, Mozambique, Angola, areas that had economic strife, they wiped out their wildlife. Yeah? Zimbabwe's been in hell for the last 20, 25 years. And I work closely with Zimparks, and they have kept it going. Zimbabwe has the second largest population of elephant after Botswana. Healthy populations of lions, wild dogs. Yeah? it is a success story. But Zimparks is actually broke.
Yeah, who's
it owns all this land? Yeah, you know, they're selling baby elephants. I'm sure you've seen that, because they need money. Yeah, it's not because they want to. It's because they're desperate, and they need to fund the organisation that fights poaching, all the rangers in the field, and so on and so forth. So to me, I think an African success story, a Zimbabwean success story, is their national parks. You know, that you know, South Africa's wiped out all there. I'll give you an example. Can anyone tell me how many elephants there were in 1900 in Zimbabwe? I'll give you a clue. There are 85,000 today.
Half a million.
800. The white hunter went through there and absolutely wiped out wildlife. So it can recover. It really can. It can work. You know, wildlife areas do regenerate. Zambia lost all its wildlife. It was used to fund the ANC. The ANC could use all that. Now South Luangwa, Kafue, North Luangwa, major parks that tourists flock to. I'm sure many of you have been there. So yes, it can. You know, the question on hunting, it's complicated. None of the things that we look at in conservation are easy. There's no real easy answers, but there's a lot of hard work and there's very little funds. And that's what we're up against. But,
One final point, Nick.
Yes.
I'm just so pleased that 30 years ago you called me a tree hugging conservationist. Now look at you. Fantastic.
I think that's lovely. That's absolutely fantastic. I mean, I must say that, yeah, I was part of the Thatcher Revolution. Wild dogs didn't even naturally get their head above the den. So. Thank you, Chris. Can I just end by just showing you a quick 4-minute video, and then we can just have a little more to drink. But this will just sum up what I've been talking about.
Running out of time. Do we not rock? I'd just like.
I'd just like to add my own congratulations, Nick. I think that was an absolutely fantastic talk, a fantastic hour. I really hope that you've got something out of it. We're now going to spend another half an hour for those that want to having some more of the painted balls of your wine next door for those that want to. But you'll have noticed Nick's got a whole lot of his books here, which if you feel so inclined, love you to buy. Or we've got another scheme which it pledges, if you pledge £100 to the scheme, you get your book for free, but the Painting Board Foundation actually gets the textbook at £100, so it makes £125. So you're welcome to do either. But thank you once again for coming. I hope you found it as fascinating and wonderful talk as I have. Nick, you've done a fantastic job, thank you.